Well, hello and welcome back to the Force Friday Show, where we discuss all things Star Wars. Joining me today, as ever, is Stephen to discuss a whole host of various different topics. That sounded very strange, that whole there. But I digress, the headline, because I'm not going to do it again, Stephen, is all about Star Wars Project, being developed by Game of Thrones, also producers Benioff and Weiss, being confirmed as a trilogy, and this has been confirmed via an unusual source. It's the HBO president, Casey Boyes, revealed in an interview talking to TV Line, and he was discussing, obviously, Dan and David, and he says, once they finish up the final season of Game of Thrones, they're going off to be whisked into the Star Wars universe, and he confirmed they dropped that it's going to be a trilogy. So first things first, before I pass it off to you, Stephen, do you think that the mouse is going to get his kneecaps done in?
Yeah.
Because we do know that they don't like information getting leaked unless it's absolutely necessary and it has their fingerprints on it.
No.
So is he going to get his kneecaps done? And are you excited at the fact that this is indeed going to be a trilogy now? Because before it was always known as a series of films. Yeah. So are you disappointed it's not going to be perhaps more than a trilogy? Or are you just happy that you are getting another trilogy out with the Rian Johnson?
I'll take that question first. I think I could only really answer that after seeing their first film, whether or not I want them to continue on doing a series of films. Yeah. Committing ourselves, according to this article, to a trilogy says otherwise that...
to be fair, it's not absolutely 100% confirmed that it's a trilogy. He says the delay has to do with the fact, in brackets, that they were offered three movies. Now, being offered three movies and accepting three movies isn't the same thing. They may have offered them three movies and they decide, no, we'll do one film and see
so
how...
So it's really a trilogy of films rather than a...
Trilogy of films,
A series trilogy.
Yeah, it might not be an interconnected start. Well, that
makes sense.
They may have knocked it back.
The success of Game of Thrones really speaks volumes about these two guys. Yeah. It doesn't actually say they're going to be directing the films, does it? It just says that they're the executive producers, is that right?
Yeah, I think there's always...
So they're going to have a big say in who's directing these films, if I'm reading that right.
Yeah, the way I've always read it is that they would be producing and perhaps writing the scripts for the films. Whether they direct it as well, I'm not too sure. I don't think that they direct the Game of Thrones episodes. I think they do a similar thing to, obviously, what we're seeing in The Mandalorian, where they'll bring in a patchwork quilt of different directors all coming in to do their own. But that's something that's happened time and again with just about every TV show in the history of TV shows, Steve.
Well, I think, John, when it was initially announced, it was at the same time as the Rian Johnson trilogy. That was always confirmed that it was going to be a trilogy from Rian Johnson. I was more excited in what Benioff and Weiss were going to be doing because they were saying it was a series of films. Mm-hmm. And I was kind of glad as well that they were going to be moving away finally from trilogies. Mm. But you've kind of cleared that one up. It might not mean it's going to be a contained story within three films. Yeah. It could be three separate films they're doing. They're committed to three separate films.
Yeah.
It could be in different time periods as well. I hope it's going to be around about the Old Republic time. I hope it is anyway.
Yeah, I think
it's about time they cover this era in the Star Wars mythology. And these are the guys to do it. We've seen it's been tried and tested and passed with the Game of Thrones series. I'm looking forward. What was the other question you asked me again?
The other one was, do you think that the person responsible for leaking this information, the HBO president, Casey Boyes, do you think the House of Mouse, or whatever the hell they call it, the mouse, is going to send assassins around to kneecap this guy?
Well, the guy's not... I don't believe he's contractually obliged to you know, fall under the rules of...
No, he's not. No.
Disney dictate. He's obviously...
But as we do know, Disney have their finger in just about every pie in Hollywood, Stephen. They're taking over their joints. So.
He is the president of HBO. I think he's a very powerful guy. I don't think he cares, to be honest with you, John. I think it's a lot more information than Disney would like being released to the public, but... it's good news because it means that the wheels are in motion for these guys to come in and do their thing.
Absolutely.
This is the one that I'm looking forward to in the film series rather than the Rian Johnson stuff. And that's nothing to do with The Last Jedi. Rian Johnson is an amazing filmmaker.
Yeah.
He still is. I've not changed my opinion on him. Parts of The Last Jedi I didn't like, but it's not all Rian Johnson's
Stephen, as we did discuss previously, man, issue with The Last Jedi wasn't so much Rian Johnson himself, it was being backed into a corner, having to take the events of this film almost seamlessly, well, completely seamlessly from the events of The Force Awakens. It ran straight in from the end of the Force Awakens. He didn't have time or a time jump to really freshen up certain arcs and say, well, this is what's happened in the intervening time. Yeah. He had to go right into it and it backed him into a corner. And just having that monkey on the back of just these legacy characters and how you handle them, you can never please every fan.
I've got a question for you though, John. Yeah. Buying off and wise, having three films, would you prefer them being three individual separate films, or would you prefer them having a trilogy of a continuing story?
Well, again, that just depends, Stephen, on the time era and just what they're going to be doing with this. I want to see them doing the Old Republic. I'd be quite happy to see perhaps three individual semi-connected stories set in the era of the Old Republic, maybe focusing on the likes of Darth Bane, focusing on the rise of the Sith Empire and just that battle between the early Jedis, and perhaps going off and maybe doing another story about, I think it was Bastila, I can't remember what her name is, that great Jedi character from the Knights of the Old Republic. They could do that, they could do this set in a similar kind of era, but it's kind of a different perspective, different stories happening within the same universe or galaxy, similar time frame. I'd be quite happy to see that. Otherwise, I'd be quite happy to see it being one interconnected trilogy with a whole host of new characters. It's really up to Benioff and Weiss. They've proven themselves to be fantastic producers. They can take great sort of stories and obviously, what you call his, I forget his bloody name, George R. R. Martin.
Yeah.
The Song of Ice and Fire. They've took his great stories, but of course, George is notoriously lazy. He doesn't finish his books for like 10 years, so he's actually behind the TV show now. And they've since overtook him, and they've proven themselves that they can take fresh and original stuff and maybe flesh it up and go off. And they went off in a different direction anyway from the books a long time ago.
Yeah.
So they've proven themselves that they can handle great stories and great characters and flesh it out and give us beautiful, colourful arcs and worlds and stuff like that. So I think they will get it right regardless of what they do, Stephen. I hope it's the Old Republic though, because as you did say with Game of Thrones, this is a genre and a setting that they can really flex their muscles in, and I think they do it justice. And everybody wants this Old Republic, man. It's completely separate from a saga, and it give the audience that perhaps aren't aware of this great time period a chance to be invested in these fantastic new characters. So yeah, I'd be, cannot wait, man.
Yeah.
But I guess we shall move on. I just had to clear my throat there, Stephen. Yeah. Sorry about that.
No problem.
Next topic, this one will perhaps be a little bit shorter, certainly sweeter. It's all about Star Wars Episode 9 and R2-D2's rapping film.
Yeah.
He's rap film, he's not rapping, he's rapped the film. Obviously it's a new actor playing the infamous astromech droid. That's Jimmy V who's playing him now, not the late Kenny Baker, who's sadly passed away. But he went on to, I believe it was Twitter or Instagram, and he obviously messaged Anthony Daniels, he hashtagged him, so I presume it's Twitter, and says, it's been a pleasure working with you, hashtag Anthony Daniels, C3PO Star Wars. So he's wrapped up his
said all his lines,
episode 9, he's said all his lines, beep beep bump bump and stuff like that, Jim Carrey from Fun with Dick and Jane, and he's done. So I take two things from this, Stephen. First of all, R2-D2's finished in the saga trilogy as we know it for now, but the other thing I take is that with C3PO Anthony Daniels wrapping up last week, R2-D2 and Jimmy V wrapping up this week, that tells me that they're separate. They've been off and doing different things in this film. Which, well, they might not be for the entire film. I mean, they could have crossed paths during the production, but we've never seen these two characters really together in this new saga trilogy.
And that's a
shame.
I would be more concerned if it was, or maybe last week, if it was Mark Hamill that was wrapping filming up.
He's just
Anthony
started.
Daniels. Yeah. Exactly. You know, and that's more encouraging to me that he's not wrapped up very quickly. It's going to happen. I think we're going to get the more prominent stars announcing these things as the is he prominent?
Yeah, he is now. He's more prominent than R2-D2, sadly.
There's no one in that machine though, isn't there?
No, so it's just the CG guys in the green suits.
Don't think they're going to announce their wrapped filming, but the likes of Oscar Isaac, John Boyega, the likes of
Adam Driver
as well. I couldn't remember his name. Daisy Ridley as well. They'll be later on, I think. Maybe come maybe early summer. They'll probably have some reshoots and stuff like that they'll have to get back to. In regards to this, Jimmy V, very much like the big chap that took over from Peter Mayhew, holds the character very close to his heart.
Jonas Sutamo.
That's the one. I said big chap, and he certainly has a big chap. This chap was a very small chap. And listen, it's great to
and
see
it looks like a combination of Phil Mitchell, Stephen, and Johnny Rotten
and Billy Mitchell.
All right, Mark.
Yeah, but listen, it's good to see. It's good to see that you know the. I didn't even know who Jimmy V was. Pardon my ignorance, but it's good to see these guys getting some recognition for their work and playing such an iconic role as well. Kenny Baker passed away in 2016. I think we were on holiday actually when it happened.
I toasted them with a Jack Daniels.
Yeah, certainly big shoes to fill there in regards to you know that character. It's always nice to put a human element on these characters, especially for the actors. I think because Mark Hamill said this. You know, working on the set at the Dagobah set, it was only him. R2 and Frank Oz.
Frank Oz. Yeah.
So it was very hard for him to work with, you know, a Muppet, as he described, you know, at the time.
That's a terrible thing to call Frank Oz.
It was for months on end. So yeah. It was nice to. It's always nice to know there's someone or some human behind, you know, the character. Certainly in the regards to the original trilogy, Kenny Baker, I think, added a lot of life to the R2 character. Same with Anthony Daniels as well. A bit trickier because he had a lot more voice work to do. Coming from a mime background, I think Anthony Daniels came from. He was a perfect guy for the role because
very skinny.
Yeah, very certainly was skinny, and also he knew how to express the you know his body and his movements as well to make the character very convincing. Yeah. So I don't think people should underestimate. You know, the human aspect to these characters. No. And Jimmy V is embracing this, and I'm glad to see it.
Yeah, Stephen, I'm just happy to see people getting involved with this great franchise, all shapes and sizes, all talents.
Definitely.
It's always great to see them being immersed in this fantastic world. I'd love to be a part of it. Mm-hmm. Sadly, I'm neither talented enough nor connected enough to get in, which is a real shame for me. But look, man, as you did say, he's invested some personality into this character, just like Kenny Baker did before him. And it does, having someone inside that, gives it a bit more humanity. Yeah. I don't know why, but it does.
Yeah.
But look, I just hope that R2-D2 gets a sizeable role in this film because he, for me, has been one of my mainstays. Oh, he's been a mainstay throughout every single Star Wars film, just about. And he's a real iconic character, one that I always had a connection with. Really loved him and C-3PO. So it's been a real sad, kind of a dark part of this sequel trilogy that they've not been in sizeable roles. And it's kind of baton's been needlessly passed off to BB-8. I mean, I like BB-8. It's a colourful little rounded git.
Felt that BB-8's role in The Last Jedi was very minimal.
It was,
well, you know, they had that black droid as well, the First Order droid at the very end, which I thought was pretty cool looking. But you're right. It's I think these two characters have took a back step in this trilogy, and that's just due to marketing of the toys and stuff like that. It's going to happen in this day and age, you know.
I think it's just representative of the whole legacy characters in general, Stephen, taking a back step to this new generation.
Yeah.
Sad, but that's just life. Time moves on, and if you don't move with the times, you get left behind, and these characters have been left behind. But I'm going to leave that topic behind, Stephen, and move swiftly on to the next
topic.
That's a nice transition for me, anyway. This next topic is all about Star Wars Episode 9. Surprise, surprise. Reportedly, only J.J. Abrams knows the title, Stephen. This is Dominic Monaghan, I do believe. He may have posted this via some social media platform, I don't know which one it was, I think it was Twitter, and it says, to a fan, episode 9 title, pretty please, as if that's going to work, how can I make your Monday easier, not be giving you the title clearly, it says only J.J. Abrams official knows it's good to have secrets in Star Wars, and he's right, it's great to see J.J.'s keeping an element of the mystery box intact, because as we will get into in the final topic, Stephen, there's been a leak, which is very unlike JJ in his production. He usually keeps a tight lid on these things, but look, he's holding the secret to the title until it gets released. Are you happy with that? Are you ambivalent towards that? Are you whelmed at all? I don't know.
If this is going to be the last saga film, John, I don't mind them holding it back for a little while longer. I'm going to get it eventually. But to be in his shoes and knowing that he knows the title is a very unique position for anyone. He must have thoughts on how the fans will react to this title as well, because as you know, you can't please everyone.
No.
We've seen it. So I think everybody liked the title of The Last Jedi, Although it did raise a debate on who was the last Jedi for months on end.
Yeah, you always need that bit of ambiguity, though, Stephen, these titles.
The Force Awakens, I think, didn't get much scrutiny either. Mm-hmm. The likes of The Phantom Menace and Attack of the Clones, on the other hand, did. And I can understand why.
The Phantom Menace, yeah.
I don't mind it now. Attack of the Clones is
the
one.
It's just the worst bit of false marketing I've ever seen in my life. At no point do the clones attack unless you're on the GNOs and Trade Federation side, in which case they do attack.
Getting back to JJ, I think we're going to get it in the next month or so. I think maybe 4 to 6 weeks we will know finally the title. I did think, and I did mention this on one of our audio shows a couple of months before Christmas, that we would get it for January. I was wrong. Don't mind being wrong, but I think I'm not in any hurry. I don't really mind now. It's going to be the last one of the Skywalker saga. Yeah. Some of the titles that have come up on the rumour mill on Reddit or whatever,
I will get into that shortly.
I've been really poor. Some of them have been okay, but there's been a lot of ones out there that I've went, no, definitely not.
No, yeah. Look, Stephen, I agree with you about the timeline. I think it'll come out just prior to Celebration, which is, of course, in April. In Chicago, so I think we'll get the trailer first, and Celebration. Might get the title just released on the Star Wars website, much like The Last Jedi did.
Yeah.
Maybe mid to late March, that's what I would think now. And you're right, Stephen, this film's still 8, 9, 10 months away. You know what I mean? It's 10 months away. So it's a long, long time to go. I think I'm guilty of it as well, to be fair, that fans of Star Wars tend to get a little bit impatient with these things. I was expecting a bloody trailer. Teaser trailer last year. What are you doing, John? It's over a year away. It's not going to happen, son. You'd never expect that for any other franchise or film, but it becomes an expectancy when it's Star Wars, and it's just it's not on. But I'm completely trust JJ to pick the right title, but I'll go through with some of these titles, Stephen. Potential titles again. We seem to do this on a weekly basis, but they're saying number 10, the best, A New Order. I do like A New Order because it's got that ambiguity. Could it be A New Order of the Republic? A New Order of the Jedi? Could it be A New Order of the Sith? Knights of Ren? On the First
Hope,
Order. That's still a fun favourite of mine. Ashes of Empire, no, absolutely terrible, man. The Ashes of Empire has been done. The First Order was the Phoenix that rose from
it's
the Ashes.
Not a very, it's not a very good title, but if it was going to be used, I would use that in the middle of a trilogy, not for the conclusion.
Or the beginning in this case, because it's the Phoenix rising from the Ashes of the Empire, the First Order. It's been done. You get on with it. Number 8, they're saying Spark of Hope. No.
Sounds like a Fast and Furious subtitle.
Spark of Hope. I think, again, we've already had that. Yeah. That's the first or second one, I don't know. When the good guys are maybe down in a loaf slump in the middle of a trilogy, you do a Spark of Hope. Son of Darkness, done to the death and an abomination. Should never see the light of the day. After that, The New Order rises. No.
Too much. It's
too much going on there, It's too hard. Order of Ren.
Nah. No. That sounds like a Chinese takeaway place.
Order of Ren, it does, doesn't it? Order of Ren.
Don't like that. I'll have a Ren, please, and fried rice.
I'll have salt and pepper chicken from Order of Ren down the road. The Last Hope. God, no.
That sounds depressing, doesn't it?
The Last Hope. Rebellion Reborn.
No.
And they've chosen Admiral Holdo. I don't know what that's about. She killed herself.
I think she might have quoted that, actually.
Oh, yeah, she did.
I think, I can't remember.
Yeah, she did. Rebellion Reborn, I'm pretty sure she did. Yeah. No, Rebellion Reborn, no. Balance of the Force.
No, I don't. The Balance of the Force was highlighted in The Last Jedi with Snoke. He says his one, rises.
The other one will rise to meet it.
Kind of, you're just readdressing
which
that.
Which I always found quite funny and humorous, Stephen, because if that was the case, why did the Force not rise so violently and quickly in the original trilogy? Yeah. Or in the prequel trilogy when there was 70 million Jedi roaming around? And we only had two Sith.
Yeah.
We only had two Sith. So why did it not rise to combat that, the original trilogy? Darth Vader's murdered just about every Jedi out there. Yoda's a hermit. The Emperor's Sheev Palpatine himself is committing absolute tyranny on the galaxy, and we've got one fanboy, whiny little bitch who takes about 5 years to rise to meet the threat. Doesn't work like that, the Force. His hand says that's not how the Force works, but we'll not go there. Number two, I've done number two, that's Balance of the Force. Number one, Reign of Darkness.
Oh, that's too dark.
Reign of Darkness.
That's depressing. That again, that's a middle title. That's not one that offers any hope.
Unless this is just going to be the middle part of another interconnected trilogy, which is
we are assuming that this episode 9 is going to have a happy ending. Yeah, not actually said it is. Like, you know, so
what a nice little twist that would be, you know, for Star Wars to finally get down that rabbit hole, Steve, and go a dark with the ending of a trilogy. I don't know, but I don't think there's going to be any of them. But if it was any and I had the choice, it would be A New Order, because that for me is the best of a bad lot. But I hope JJ's came up with something better, and his creative juices have been flowing a little bit more than that. But I digress, I've not looked much more to add, Stephen.
No.
And we will move on to the final topic on this week's Force Friday show, and it's all about an episode 9 leak revealing Kylo's new helmet, Rey's Jedi Rose, a whole other treasure trove of a little leaky goodness, Stephen. There's a whole menagerie of photos going on here.
Yeah.
First things first, we've got something that looks like straight out of the set of Labyrinth from back in the 1980s.
Yeah. Yeah, it's definitely one Jennifer of Jim
Connelly
Henson's,
and David Bowie. Better not David say that. That rails certain people up, Stephen. You know who I'm talking about.
B looks like a unicycle.
One of the droid, the battle droids from Phantom Menace.
I was going to say that, or a Tannoy.
Where are you taking him? You know? To Coruscant.
But C is very interesting. This is
Richard E. Grant, he's playing a goddamn First Order Imperial or officer.
Looks very much like Tarkin now, yeah.
He does. He's English, and he was always going to play a baddie. Stephen, because that's what English people play. They play baddies because of the British Empire. I'm just
not sure what D is. It looks like a rebel.
Yeah, that's just a resistance.
Yeah,
pleb.
Yeah, definitely.
Plebington, and then of course E looks like Dominic Monaghan.
It definitely is. Yeah,
and he looks like either a vagabond, sort of a smuggler type, or he is obviously a part of the resistance.
He's actually wearing the same attire as Finn did in Last Jedi.
You're right,
same sort of
the shirt
and the trousers.
It's giving me a whole host of Han vibes as well, Return of the Jedi at the beginning.
The shirt
slightly different coloured shirt. F, very intriguing.
It's a bit colourful to be a Knights of Ren, isn't it? But the actual
you don't know that, Stephen. Maybe a fanciful character.
Yeah,
what is going on with the Rubik's Cube that is the Mon Calamari there?
He looks like he's lost a game anyway with that face.
They always look like the Forest game, Stephen. They're squids. And Rey, most importantly, channeling her inner Padme from Attack of the Clones with all white gear.
Yeah.
Looks very intriguing. Again, showing us that she is very much the good side of the
Which is interesting
force.
When we get back to episode 6 with Luke, his entrance, he's all black, and leaves you, what's happened? You know, here, it's very obvious that she is the light side.
Is this a double bluff, Stephen? Is she going to turn to the dark? I have to say, of all of these leaks, there's a couple really catch my eye, but the one that definitely catches my eye is Kylo Ren's new gear, his new get-up, and a very familiar-looking helmet, which looks as though it's been super glued back together with some very ominous-looking red glowy glue.
Yeah.
It's very much the same helmet, but I'm pleased to see it's back. It should never have been destroyed. Snoke was absolutely dead wrong. He was not like a petulant child in that helmet. That voice is incredible. The first moment I heard him say, "You're so right," and stuff. It was iconic.
Jakku,
and I absolutely loved it.
Just looking at Poe Dameron, looks very much like Indiana Jones there. And his get up.
Yeah, he does.
I can't really say much more.
What's
that?
What is L? Yeah, but I'll let you
L, no, here. Sorry. L is.
Looks like one of those commentators, Stephen, those tri headed or double headed commentators from the pod race on Tatooine from the Phantom Menace. Looks stoned out.
Speaking of prequel characters, that M as well with the horns looks like kind of Hellboy type thing.
Yeah.
Looks quite smug about something. He's got a boiler suit on. Don't know what that is. N looks like a negative of Venom.
It does.
Looks very.
He could be a Knight of Ren.
Yeah.
He could be.
Judging by the costume he's wearing, I think
he
could be, yeah.
Wow. Right, yeah, that's not what I'm talking about, Stephen. That's the next one.
Lando, you're talking about Abba. We'll get to that in a minute. Sergeant Pepper.
Boney M.
But getting back to Lando. This is the same costume Donald Glover.
Donald Glover, the yellow.
Lando, he's a cool.
Looks very cool. He's looking very sprightly for his age. I'm really delighted to see Billy Dee Williams finally back reprising that role, Stephen. We're ending on an absolutely mental note with these final two photos, though.
Yeah.
That looks like an ABBA Boney M tribute group. It looks like the mob that done September. Do you remember?
Well, yeah, Earth, Wind and Fire, yeah. This could be a cantina scene or something like that. See the band, you know. It's going to be a very Lord. Disco sort of feel to it. You like the sound of this? No,
no, they don't strike me as a disco band at all, Stephen. No. They look very dark and ominous. It looks like a sort of a cultist, satanic ritual group meets Star Wars. It's very, very strange indeed. But Q is even stranger. It looks like a strange...
A slug or something like that?
Yeah, it looks like a slug, but it looks like a slug meets a caterpillar in a slightly unhinged, deranged, dark fantasy.
Yeah.
It's
interesting to see, just going back to the article though, John, it's interesting to see that these have been leaked, especially the Richard D. Grant one, because at this point we didn't know what his role was going to be. Yeah, nine times out of ten, he's a British actor, he's played the villain once or twice, everything pointing in the direction of being an Imperial officer or a First Order officer, and it's basically confirmed here. Yep. I think he's very Tarkin-esque.
Yes.
With his, you know, his slick back hair.
Yeah.
The boots as well. It looks like, you know the story about Peter Cushing couldn't wear the boots. I think his feet were too big for the boots. And for most of the filming of A New Hope, he wore slippers on the Death Star. But
and
certainly
such
here.
The stature of a man, he was very much holding his own next to David Prowse in those big, massive Cuban heel.
But what I take from this, John, this leak, is I'm glad to see Kylo Ren has got the helmet back as well.
Absolutely.
I think that was one thing that I don't think should have been removed from The Force Awakens. Or
it's just too youthful.
I'm kind of caught in between here, because Adam Driver's a fantastic actor, and I don't think someone of his calibre should be hiding behind a mask to begin with. But I'm conflicted, because the character I thought was more menacing with the mask on, but you're regurgitating the Darth Vader story going down that road.
Yeah.
So hats off for them for unmasking the villain of the trilogy, if you like.
Yeah.
But I like to see it coming back, and I like the way it looks like it's been sort of melded together again in some kind of fashion.
It's glowing.
And it's glowing as well. It looks very much Mustafa as well from the glowing. But some of the characters are very colourful, as we saw. It's good to see Lando's back and his get-up as well. Rey could be a misdirection on the way she's dressed. I don't think it is. I think it's going to be very straight down the line. She's the light side of the Force, and I am wearing white.
Yeah, Stephen, I completely agree, man. It's a very colourful menagerie of photos, as I did say. But I'll end the show, Stephen, very briefly and shortly, because we're running out of battery on that camera there. I know we are. On another little rumoured leak regarding perhaps a bigger villain popping up in usurping Kylo Ren. There was rumours of a leak coming that the Knights of Ren would come from the Outer Rims, bringing back rumours of a greater force and threat. What would you make of that, Stephen? Would you be happy to see that? And could this potentially open up the door for a Kylo Ren redemption story?
I think they're leaving it too late, John. I think there's too much to sort of wrap up in this film. I think if they were going to do that, they should have done it maybe in the middle.
Yeah.
The Snoke storyline should have maybe been kept for the beginning part, The Force Awakens, the throne room and stuff like that, and maybe using that storyline in the middle so they can sort of tie it up in the last movie. I think they've left it a little bit too late. But it really depends on where they want to go with it. You've still got the Knights of Ren as well. I know that J.J. Abrams wanted to utilise them in some fashion and The Force Awakens couldn't. Too many introducing the old characters, the new characters, bringing everyone back on board, trying to win everyone over that was a bit butthurt from the prequels. A lot was on his plate in regards to that. He did it nicely in that little sort of sequence that we saw in The Knights of Ren. And Rian Johnson explained why he didn't use them. I get that. So I don't really know. I think maybe that kind of storyline may be a little bit too late.
Yeah.
Unless it's at the beginning of the movie right away and we get right into it, you know?
Yeah, I don't know, Stephen. That's something that intrigues me. Just seeing Nikhil, the Knights of Ren coming back is something that's definitely on my bucket list for this trilogy before they pack it up and call it a night. So I hope the rumoured leak is true, that they come back from the Outer Rim one way or the other.
Mm-hmm.
Or just the Uncharted regions of the galaxy, not the Outer Rim, talking crap there, the Uncharted regions. Whether they bring another knowledge of another threat that may come in and usurp Kylo Ren as a bigger, big bad villain, Lord knows, Stephen, that'd be something very intriguing. If it does lend itself to a potential redemption of Kylo Ren, Ben Solo, then it's something I'm all for, because I want to see the character being redeemed. He's my favourite character in this trilogy, the most complex and interesting character for me, so I would be delighted to see that happen. But one way or the other, I just hope to see the Knights of Ren in some vein.
Definitely.
Completely agree, though, before I end it, that it would have to be at the beginning of the film, because it would be too late otherwise, trying to shoehorn everything in, it would feel too convoluted.
They could do a, you know, in the opening crawl. Just
the
give a paragraph what's happening here right now and get right into it.
Yeah, that'd be brilliant. Yeah. And it'd make for a very quick paced and frenetic film from start to finish, which is what we need.
Yep.
But I digress, Stephen. That is going to round up this week's episode of The Force Friday Show, where we do discuss all things Star Wars. If you're enjoying the content we're putting out, don't forget to comment below and tell us exactly what you thought, like the video, and subscribe to the channel. And we will be back next Tuesday with Box Office Chat.